This week on Crunch Week, we're talking about Apple's new iPhone trade-in program, Foursquare's potential investment from Microsoft, and Twitter's Blue Lines problem. Welcome to Crunch Week. I'm Lena Rao.
I'm Colleen Taylor.
And I'm Anthony Ha.
This week was obviously a chock full of news. The first one I think that was kind of interesting was Apple's new iPhone trade-in program, which was confirmed by Apple, and now they're sort of widely going to be rolling out this nationwide initiative to allow people to trade in their very expensive iPhones and get credit for newer iPhones. And it extends to like the first generation iPhone to, you know, currently. So it's kind of interesting because Apple hasn't really done this in the past. I mean, right.
They've had e-recycling programs.
That's right. Yeah,
but not like, this kind of
not like a credit, you know. Yeah. And they're actually like some of the phones are getting pretty decent money that you can use to then purchase another iPhone. So I it seems like a no-brainer. But then at the same time, like you have to kind of stack the financials against like. If you did trade it in at Verizon, like what would they give you there versus what they would give you at Apple, and like how to deal with your like plan? That's that whole thing comes into play.
Although I think it's also an element of like for a lot of the people, I would imagine like it's just like a convenience thing. It's like okay, now yeah. I know I can do this. It's going to be relatively easy,
right?
And I'm you know, and also just making people aware of it. I think you know makes a big difference because I've definitely got just like a big pile up of iPhones because I mean not to make it sound like I have so many iPhones, but you know you feel yeah.
My big question. Is if I go in and change, you know, exchange my iPhone or want to, you know, return my iPhone 5 for the gold iPhone 5S, but I'm on Sprint, like, how does that work with my Sprint plan? Like, do I then have to, it's kind of unclear, I think, yeah, how that works.
I have no idea.
Well, you have an Android.
I mean, the same way any other sort of buying a new phone would?
Guess so, yeah. I would assume that, like, I've never bought a phone through Apple, though. I've always bought it through.
That's so weird.
Is that weird?
That's super weird.
Oh,
maybe I'm weird. I don't know.
I feel like I'm. Do you always buy it from Apple?
Yeah.
And you take
it. I go to the Apple Store, or buy. I guess now that because they're always initially sold out at the Apple Store, so now I buy it online. Yeah, and then you just add and you. I mean, if you're sticking with the same carrier,
then it's very easy. Add it.
You just turn it on, and basically Apple has handled a lot of the back end stuff already, and like. It's just like, okay, great, your other phone is no longer connected and this one's activated.
I guess this also would help Apple create more sales in their store, right? As opposed to like me going to Sprint or Best Buy or something else.
Right.
And I mean, it's going to be harder to go now if you're going to turn in the iPhone for money at the Apple store. It would probably take more work to then say, okay, well, I'm just going to take my money here and then I'm going to go buy an Android phone or something.
It keeps
people loyal. But more importantly, I think environmentally, this is a good thing.
Yeah.
Apple is always one of the companies, along with every other major tech company, that is on the bad list for Greenpeace and things like this. Their chargers have always been not part of a standard, you know, it's not USB.
Yeah, they've switched a bunch of them of late, which, you know, our colleague John Biggs wrote a great piece on sort of their wastage issue, and everyone has these, like, old chargers lying around or docks for the iPhone, and, you know, I agree. I think that's, like, this is a step in the right direction.
Right, because I don't think the worst of Apple, like, they're doing it for planned obsolescence so that people spend more money, although a lot of people do think that. But I think that it has had this unintended consequence of all these trash phones that are bad, you know, in terms of pollution. So
right, and I think that, I mean, people pick on Apple specifically because, again, I think it's easy to sort of look at Apple fans, and you know, obviously, I mean, I sort of count myself among them, and that's like you get like the getting people because Apple is like more than anyone else kind of encourages that mentality of oh, I have to get the next one, and also I think because people think there's sort of this disconnect between sort of this sort of shiny like new thing and then sort of the invisible cost of it.
Right.
Well, Foursquare, you know, the location-based startup that has been, you know, definitely. Gone through its highs and its lows over the past few years, is reportedly in the market for a strategic investment from Microsoft, though like others have been tossing out potentially Yahoo. But, you know, the news was definitely Microsoft could be the winner in this, and there's some sort of a bidding war apparently going on.
This has been a media week for Foursquare because that has been news that came out, but then just hours before that, they did sort of an embargoed media press tour in which I talked to Dennis Crowley about their new app. They're doing automatic passive push notifications now to Android phones. This is an app that they're rolling out very slowly, but it's just the new version of Foursquare is no longer going to be reliant on you checking in. It's going to buzz your phone if you walk into a cafe.
Which is huge. I mean, it is huge.
To be fair, it's something that Foursquare has done before. Back in 2011, they turned on Radar, which was a feature, but that was an opt-in feature only on iOS, and it wasn't that successful. Crowley says that that's because the technology wasn't advanced enough. It ran down your battery too much. People just weren't into it. But now the new Foursquare is going to be a very different experience, and he thinks that devices are ready now. So that was the first bit of news, but now it becomes clear maybe that they did this press push at the same time that they're looking to secure a new strategic investor, which is important for them. They need a new strategic investor. Their last funding round wasn't really a funding round.
It was debt, right?
And that's, you know, needs to be paid back at some point. So obviously a lot of things going on with Foursquare right now.
But I think, I was going to say that I think that part of, I mean, the story that they were trying to tell there, I think also was about this sort of comeback story, because I think, like you said, you know, there's been a lot of kind of like, what's going on with Foursquare? Is Foursquare kind of over? And I mean, some of that obviously is just sort of the way, you know, I think how we sort of process a lot of that news. If a company doesn't seem to be doing like amazingly well, we sort of think, oh man, it's over. Although, to be fair, I mean, a company in Foursquare's state should be like, you know, continuing to grow very fast. Otherwise, that's a problem. But I think that there was also, you know, some like, you know, some stats about some of the ads and things that are starting to actually, you know, perform in Foursquare.
I mean, and they have an enormous, Foursquare has an enormous amount of data, like, and location data, and data that can actually be sort of like, if so-and-so visited, you know, the creamery, then they might like Phil's coffee, you know, and that sort of like, or how to connect those dots. And you have to think Microsoft, considering its mobile ambitions and maybe Bing, I don't know, but they're already sort of using Foursquare data, but like, you have to think there's definitely some synergies that could happen there. And you have to think that on Yahoo's side, it could be as well. So, I mean, I guess Foursquare could have like got, you know, be a pretty lucrative partner for some of these companies that don't have that data.
Right. And I mean, to be fair, I think a lot of that stuff is kind of far off. And I mean, also in terms of the data, in terms of location based data, I think it makes available already to a lot of partners. So it's not like it's like hidden. But I do think that in terms of the personal data and monetizing that, I think that's definitely a ways off. I mean, they're getting there, but it still seems like it's, you know. Now the excitement is just like, oh, like this isn't totally a pipe dream. It seems like it's actually starting to become a reality. But there's still like a long way to go between where it is now and where I think, you know, people are like, oh, this is what it could be.
Yeah, this has been a company that's been ahead of its time in a lot of ways. I have a lot of criticisms for Foursquare, but ultimately what Dennis Crowley says the vision has always been, back when he did it as Dodgeball and now as Foursquare, is that one day we're all going to be walking around and we have these devices in our pockets and they will tell us things that we don't already know that we'll find helpful. You know, if I walk into a restaurant, it'll get a buzz and it'll say, guess what, you should order the cheeseburger because that's what people rave about. Or guess what, your friend Anthony is also here, but you just don't see him.
Right.
So that has always been their vision, and he's been working on it for a long time, a lot of bumps along the way, but you've got to give it to them.
They're not giving up.
They have a lot of smart engineers. They have a really talented team. They have beautiful apps. So we'll see. The Foursquare story goes on.
I hope it ends up being a successful one for them. Speaking of successful or unsuccessful, I guess, okay. Twitter rolled out a new feature this week, Blue Lines. Do you want to go into what
I guess more a redesign than a new, it depends on how you want to characterize it, but essentially it's organizing conversations in Twitter based on, you know, the actual sort of here's, you know, the full conversation as opposed to you have to sort of piece things together from different tweets and then using the blue lines to sort of connect them, which was, you know, I think is actually visually not that bad, but sets up a lot of sort of random jokes about blue lines. And, you know, Twitter was doing some of that before where, you know, there's a conversation button where you can hit it and you can see the full conversation, but this kind of integrates it into the mainstream the mainstream of content, which I think is what people were sort of alarmed, is that so many people have been trained to think, okay, this is just, you know, the most recent at the top, and, you know, I know exactly what this is, versus something like Facebook, where there's like an algorithm sort of ranking sort of it by like social relevance and things. Like, this is just, I know exactly what this is. Oh, now I don't.
Right. Yeah, what do you think? Do you like it?
It's growing on me. I think that it's...
I don't think it's so bad, but people are really complaining about it.
Right. I think, I mean, it seems like a lot of it is people, you know, people just sort of getting used to it. I think there's also, like, there are weird things about the way it's been implemented where I think it's like, usually you get the full conversation, the beginning and the end of the conversation, but sometimes you get the most recent thing in the conversation and then the rest of the conversation below it. So I think there are details that need to be worked out. So I think that's part of it. But I think part of it is also just, I mean, it's just something new and different and clearly meant for sort of people who aren't sort of the kind of diehard Twitter users now, but people who like may find the old layout kind of like confusing.
Is it going to encounter the fate of the infamous dick bar?
I would be very, I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if they need to tweak it, but I don't think it has that level of kind of rage that the dick bar. And so, you know, for people who don't remember, the dick bar was sort of
a bar across the top,
and it was, I think, because a lot of people saw it as sort of the first step towards the very aggressive, annoying monetization.
Dick but, for Dick Costolo?
Yeah.
Yes,
okay.
Exactly. It was a way to make it very personal. But I think that, you know, it's in that case, they were able to sort of pull that back. But then obviously there are ads in Twitter in Twitter on mobile now. And so they found a way to make it work.
Right.
And so
it may have just been like too early to like.
The design, they claimed that was always meant to be very experimental. Whereas this, I mean, it feels like, it also feels very much of a piece of other things they've been talking about, where it's all about sort of making Twitter more accessible to kind of the mainstream user,
right,
and not someone who understands the you shouldn't have to like try to learn like what a hashtag is or what an at reply is. It should just all become intuitively clear to you. I think they've got a long way to go, and I don't know if they'll ever get, but I think that's kind of what they're going for.
Yeah, I think the conversations, that is something that if you've been using Twitter for a while, it makes more sense. But then if you're a newbie, you don't really understand that if you click on it, then you'll be able to see. So the blue lines makes it more apparent, and I think this is probably something to make it more mainstream ahead of its IPO, which is probably coming up.
That's true. Well, that is all the time that we have for this week. Thanks for joining us, and tune in again next week.